Introduction. This collection of prose poems is based upon the teaching of the Buddha. The selections have been chosen for inspiration rather than representing the full span of the teaching. We have previously presented them as slides or read them aloud to friends on various occasions, such as after workshops, following assistant teacher meetings, around fireplaces in national parks, or after evening metta. They have consistently been received with appreciation and have evoked multiple requests for their publication. All of these compositions combine the Buddha's thoughts with contemporary phrasing. They cannot be considered direct quotes from the Pali Canon because we have worked only with English language translations and because we have combined similar passages or modified the language for readability. But at the same time, we can't claim these words are original to us because they are in the spirit of the Buddha. They are brief, poetic, re-speaking of some of the Buddha's most important ideas. They are sparks from the campfire that continue to glow in the dark. Our intention is that these slides or pages will inspire meditators and non-meditators alike. They are written from the authentic experience of the troubling human condition, and they speak from the standpoint of suffering and the path out of suffering. They are insights that have crossed the bridge of time from ancient India to today. We hope you will find wisdom flowing through time on the river of words that originates in the ancient spring of the Pali Canon. Paul R. and Susan K. Fleischman.
Pebbles thrown by the Buddha thousands of years ago are now landing in the pools of our minds. Within our own body, we can locate all the laws of nature, the origin of the world, the end of the world, and the path itself.
The feeling of grief follows us around like a starving village dog. Every person or situation that we love changes and disappears. This is the origin of dukkha, our dissatisfaction with the world.
Don't cling to anything. When you understand that, you understand everything. We find happiness when we discard the belief that we own ourselves and are in charge of the world. We can make choices, but we cannot hold on to everything. In any moment that we slip free from grasping, we become unburdened.
The Buddha called freedom from grasping unshakable deliverance. Wise people speak in a manner that is clear, personal, profound, and in a calming and soothing voice. Their sublime words seem to descend from above or to rise up from deep truths that will be intelligible to other good-hearted people. Wise people can explain Dhamma either briefly or in detail, revealing their wisdom in speech that is appealing and helpful.
When you meditate, effort, concentration, or equanimity have to be stressed differently from moment to moment. Strident effort can become wearying. Concentration emerges in its own time. Trying to squeeze yourself into equanimity will only frustrate you. Meditating in this way is like a goldsmith who must watch, heat, or cool the gold he is purifying so that it emerges pliant and bright, ready to make any ornament he wants. He neither overheats it nor lets it become tepid.
The strings of a guitar play well only after they've been adjusted to be neither too loose nor too tight. Balance your efforts in life and in meditation, neither forcing them nor letting them sag. Keep concentration and equanimity in relaxed tension, like the tuned string.
As a spring-fed pond wells up with water from its cool depths and also receives rain from above, sent by the rain god from time to time, so that the rain from above and the spring water from below mingle, this pond will become washed through and radiant with fresh water. No part of it will be dark, stagnant, or blind. In the same way, a meditator practicing mindfulness of her body sensations with equanimity drenches her body with awareness so that no place remains unobserved, and she moves her mind fluidly from top to bottom and bottom to top, saturated with imperturbability.
All people feel fear. Even the Buddha, before his enlightenment, had to struggle. He said, "I used to live in the jungle surrounded by feelings of anxiety. Wild animals would approach, or the wind would shake the trees. Every time a branch fell, I shuddered. I thought to myself, why do I live constantly expecting bad things to happen?" It was true that while I walked in the jungle, worry and foreboding followed me. When I stood still, worry and foreboding surrounded me like a cloud. When I lay down, worry and foreboding covered me. And when I sat down to meditate, worry and foreboding hovered like a mist.
We are told that due to his fear, the Buddha became determined to arouse tireless energy in unremitting effort to gain insight into his suffering. He concentrated his mind. He established mindfulness, and slowly, and with great effort, his mind became purified, bright, under his control. Malleable, like properly heated gold, wieldy, like the sword he used to carry, steady and imperturbable, like a Buddha. The first true knowledge he attained was the realization of equanimity. It was his fear that goaded him towards liberation.
We should be modest, but not to a fault. It's also healthy to acknowledge our own virtues. Remind yourself of moments when you have helped yourself and others. Remember when you were open-handed, charitable, giving and sharing your money and your heart. We know that you have welcomed many meditating friends into your home.
We should try to avoid the habit of passing judgment on other people. Not all of another person's accomplishments or problems are fully visible to us. Someone may be gentle and pleasant, but fearful. Another person is equally pleasant, free from fear, but lies. These two people appear similar, but have different depths, like two ponds.
Similarly, two people may be equally quick to anger, pride, and greed. But one of them also has some degree of warmth and generosity. If you are a hasty critic of people, you will see these two as being alike. Happily married people can become highly developed, and so can single people, because attainments and vulnerabilities are multiple. No one trait or accomplishment defines a person. Someone who is verbose, irritable, and vain may also possess insight that ensures progress in spite of shortcomings.
The greatest wisdom is to perceive everyone around you in their unique qualities, strengths, and limitations. Disarm your stereotypes and rapid judgments, and recognize everyone in his or her fullness. This practice of accurately noting everyone around you will make you kinder, more realistic, and will deepen your own grasp on human nature, including your own.
The Dhamma is described as being plainly visible because if we're filled with hatred, we know it. And when hatred isn't present, that is also immediately experienced by us. We can easily see some aspects of Dhamma in ourselves. When fear lifts, we feel it in our mind and in our body.
But illusion can blind us. The thought, "I know," is like opening the door to a haunted house. We should always be asking ourselves whether we really know what we think we do, and upon what basis we claim our knowledge. We should avoid becoming like the people who follow in herds, or like the people who are convinced of their own beliefs, and who become blinded to discovery.
It is helpful if we think, My goal is to become agreeable to all of my companions in the life of meditation, respected and esteemed by them. My goal is to live according to precepts and to find security and insight in my own mind by conquering discontent, anger, and fear. I hope that people who have served me by donating to centers where I have meditated have gotten from my practice the fruits that they deserve.
Our progress is gradual and not always visible to us. There is no abrupt way. When we walk into the ocean, we find it inclines and slopes down, gradually deepening. When an outdoorsman uses an axe, the handle begins to show the marks of his finger, palm, and thumb, and the hard wood erodes, without his being able to pinpoint any single moment when these changes happened. The meditative life leads to the wearing away of old patterns, even though we can't always assign a time or date to our progress.
Our meditation is worthwhile, even if it only leads to our developing the amount of metta that lasts as long as it takes us to open our eyes. If we feel we can pervade the entire world around us with metta, we have already achieved a divine stage. It is said that the Buddha once permeated the universe with the feelings of loving kindness for 7 years. When we feel kind thoughts, we automatically feel well-being.
The experienced meditator pervades all directions around her with feelings of loving kindness, everywhere, to all beings, including herself. She pervades all the orbits of the galaxies with loving kindness that is abundant, exalted, and illimitable. In her heart, there are no barriers to her metta. She does this again with compassion, joy, and equanimity.
Whatever we habitually think about will form the tendencies and patterns of our mind. When we incline our minds towards the well-being of other people, then those tendencies will arise more often, putting us at ease. When the crops are still growing in the fields, the cowherd has to monitor his herd diligently to prevent them from consuming next year's food. Similarly, our roaming minds require firm control. But just as in the last months of summer, when all the crops have been harvested from the fields and stored in villages, a cowherd can guard his cows merely by resting in the shade of a tree and keeping an eye on them. In the same way, when we have harvested kind thoughts, we can observe our minds and bodies during meditation in a relaxed manner.
When the Buddha referred to himself, he usually used the term Tathagata. This ancient title refers to his having emerged into the world without craving, and to his readiness to depart from the world without clinging or regret. He emerged and departed as all natural phenomena do, an embodiment of nature. He is present in the story, talking face to face with living people, making it clear how everything in the universe, himself included, arises and passes away.
The Tathagata is someone who understands cause and effect. He knows that our actions sculpt our future. Actions are the birthplace of our character and are the seeds of the next moment. We are the legatees of our own endeavors.
Because we may not live long enough to know the full impact of everything we have done, we can measure our choices best by observing the effects they have on our minds. Do our actions make beneficent states grow? Because we emerge from an endlessly ancient past, and because we have so many thoughts in every moment, we arise from and generate cascades of thought actions. The big events in our lives spring up from multiple actions that have been added together, subtracted from each other, multiplied, compounded, or modified by each other. Each moment has its cause, but the cause is rarely singular. Each one of us is a jungle of cause and effect, from which we are hoping to grow sturdy, towering trees of equanimity.
Four important steps that lead to happiness and welfare for meditators are perfecting skillful and effective ways to earn your living, protecting and guarding the wealth you've earned, making friends on the path who are established in virtue, generosity, and resilient adaptation to life, living with balance, neither extravagantly nor overly cautiously.
There are four more things that guide meditators towards happiness. First, there is confidence that the Buddha's path leads towards well-being. Second, is respecting all living beings and protecting the weak ones. Third, is creating a home where there is delight in giving and sharing. Remember that your own economic competence is essential for your householder's journey. Finally, there is the wisdom of understanding impermanence.
In the same way that all the rivers of the world flow down to the sea, wind down to the sea, and give their water up to it, so too the Buddha's teachings all flow down towards and become one with Nibbana. both people who are single and people who enjoy the married life of sensual pleasures are capable of flowing towards Nibbana because the current of Dhamma floats everyone who is in it to the same shoreless ocean.
It was recorded that in the ancient days, meditators living in hermitages had to carry their water uphill from the river in heavy pots. Whenever anyone noticed that the pots of water had become low, it was his job to replenish them. But if the pots were too heavy for him, he would silently gesture with a signal of the hand to someone else, and then the two men would haul the pot by lifting it, all four hands together, in silence.
How do we know when we are meditating properly? When we are living in concord, with mutual appreciation, without disputing, blending like ocean, shore, and sand, viewing each other with acceptance and generosity. Is your meditation pulsing friendship like waves?
Find noble friends, companions, and associates with whom you can share conversation about meditation in natural, unspoiled, and peaceful environments. Frequenting assemblies where Dhamma is discussed on land that is dedicated to walking the path is a way to both be inspired and to inspire others. We have friends among people, and we have friends among birds, trees, and streams.
The Tathagata was not worried whether he was liberating the whole world. He focused on teaching freedom from ignorance and purification of the mind through meditation. The word Dhamma and the word purification refer to those practices that lead beyond sorrow because they restore the clear and unbiased mind. The Tathagata explained what he knew regardless of the size of his audience. He did not worry whether he was acceptable or popular.
Just as a ripening thunderhead ascends high into the atmosphere at the end of a drought and pours life back into the shriveled crops, in the same way, there are people who arise in this world who shower goodness and happiness on many people.
Consider a man or a woman lost on a lonely mountain range who stumbled upon an ancient path, an ancient trail, trod by the feet of travelers long ago. And he or she turned onto it and followed this footpath through the wilderness until he or she found an ancient city, a sacred wheel-shaped ground, where wise rulers once held court with palaces, observatories, meadows, and flowering groves surrounded by stone walls placed by generations of loving hands. In the same way, the Tathagata, too, found the original path for crossing the mountain ranges, traversing the dark forest, the one and only way worn by the feet of the fully enlightened ones of old.
One evening, when the Buddha was growing old, he sat with his back warming in the rays of the setting sun. Ananda massaged his limbs and noticed that his skin was no longer clear and bright. His arms and legs were weak and blotched, and his spine was bowed over like a tired old man. He changed his position to rest his back against a pillar, and he told Ananda, "My back is uncomfortable. I need to rest it." Then he folded his worn robes and lay down on his right side like a lion, alert and fully aware.
The Buddha has said, "I have taught the Dhamma, keeping nothing secret, saying nothing esoteric. The Tathagata teaches with an open hand, holding nothing back, revealing everything, grasping nothing in a fist. If there is anyone who thinks all meditators from now on should refer to me as their teacher, let him say so. But a Tathagata does not think like that." The Tathagata did not know or claim to foresee the future of his dispensation. Like the rain cloud, he scattered his teaching everywhere around him. The grass will grow differently in each of the next generations.
Constantly referring to a teacher or flattering his name is not a way to pay him your respects. A meditator pays homage to the Buddha by meditating, living the virtuous life, and building a community of like-minded friends. To pay homage to the Buddha, be equanimous, free from turmoil, contented, a vessel of gladness.
In the end, the Buddha said, "I am now old and worn out, someone who has walked the long trail to its end. I have made it to my honored 80th year. Just as an old horse is helped to hobble forward by having knee braces and ankle braces wrapped around his weakened joints, in the same way, the Tathagata's body is kept going by bandages and straps. Therefore, live as islands on your own. Live as lights of your own wisdom. Be your own refuge with Dhamma as your island and your light."
Wander the world for the benefit of all, for the happiness of all, out of compassion for the lonely and the lost, for the well-being and happiness of gods and people. Dare to walk alone, unaccompanied, teaching that which is true at its beginning, middle, and end, the same in letter and spirit, the same in words and actions. teach the holy life by living it.